It's time to finalize the work before the Wednesday seminar. Journalism is the collection and publication or transmission of news.
Just wait a minute. I will be with you shortly.
Please read the first 5 chapters before the next week's tutorial.
In this library, the reserve collection of books can be borrowed for up to 3 hours.
The residence hall is closed prior to the academic building at the end of the semester. She has been in the library for a long time.
She is an expert in 18th century French literature.
She used to be everywhere, but today she is missing.
Sport is the main cause of traumatic brain injury in the United States.
Turner, not surprisingly, painted one of the earliest pictures of London's fog in this 1835 painting, The Thames Above Waterloo Bridge. Turner, as a true bon Londoner, is advertising his familiarity with London's a problem by putting smoke and atmospheric pollution at its center. And as you can see in here, the bridge is the central elements, which is a theme that's later taken up by Monet and is partly obscured by the steam and smoke which rises from both sides of the river. Here we see a shot tower, I think you can just about see it, which was constructed in 1826. Do you know what shakis are? They produce shotguns and munition, and they were very smoky. One of the most smoking industries, but it's barely visible as you can see, as are the various industries on the Lambert side of the river. There's on this side, there's a steamship about to dock or preparing to leave, its black smoke thrusting up to join the kind of swirling arc of smoke there. William Rudner sees this painting as a potent essay on the energy and complexity of modern polluted urbanism. Smoke, I think, here represents a flourishing economy which brings employment and food on tables, but also the dirt and pollution associated with it fumes. All seems to be tainted by sulfurous yellow. Even the black plumes of smoke from the two funnels of the steam eye have yellow streaks in them to give them a greater sense of movement and vitality.
But when we move into working with communities, we have to recognize that the communities have to be the authority in their language. Actually, a woman in the class I'm teaching at Sydney at the moment, a career woman, expressed this very nicely. Although she was talking about something else, she was distinguishing expertise from authority, and certainly linguists, because of our training, we do have expertise in certain very narrow areas of language. But we don't have the authority over what to do with that knowledge or what to do with other knowledge that the community produces. I guess for me the bottom line is languages are lost because of the dominance of one people over another. That's not rocket science. It's not hard to work that out. But then what that means is, if in working with language revival we continue to hold the authority, we actually haven't done anything towards undoing how languages are lost in the first place. So in a sense the languages are still lost if the authority is still lost.
If someone has a couple of kids, how many kids does he have? If someone has a couple of kids, how many kids does he have?
What is contained in poisonous animals? What is contained in poisonous animals?
What shines at night in the sky and uses its own brightness?
What is 1/2 of 100%? What is 1/2 of 100%?
What are the things called that you touch with your left hand when you play a guitar?
What is the opposite to successor?
If you want to read tragedies or comedies, what genre of book do you read?
What do you call a book where you arrange all of your photos together?
What force makes humans stay on the earth?
How often does February have one extra day?